Brothers and sisters, friends, family, happy Easter. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Today, we recognize Jesus' resurrection, his actual physical rising from the dead. Our faith, the Christian faith, is entirely dependent on that event, that one historical event. Without the resurrection, we have no Christian faith. We have no church. We have nothing. We just have a social club. That's it. The resurrection unites Christians. It's our highest, holiest holiday. And I know we love Christmas, and Christmas is important, yes. But the resurrection is where it is. Without the resurrection, there is no life for us. So truly, happy Easter, happy Resurrection Sunday. Praise God Almighty. Let's pray. Jesus, we just thank you for what today means for each of us here. It's really hard to put into words, to find the right words to thank you and praise you and honor you. Today, well, it's here. We are celebrating our lives because of Jesus, because of your Son's work on the cross, God. Because of his death, but also because of his resurrection. Lord, I lift up today, and I pray that every believer watching this morning can begin to understand and appreciate, to celebrate what today really means for each one of us, but also for all of us collectively as a body. Lord, everything is dependent on today. It is the foundation of our faith and our hope, our trust. It's the foundation of our eternal life. The foundation of our membership within the kingdom, our adoption. Lord, we just praise you. And for our friends out there who are watching, who haven't fully understood or fully received what that means, I pray that your Spirit would work within their hearts and minds as well. Maybe today, for the first time, they are beginning to recognize and understand the faith brings hope that is real. Because of Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. Amen. Again, happy Easter. We'll be reading this morning from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 23, verses 39 to 43. So Luke, chapter 23, verses 39 to 43. Before I read the scripture verse, I want to explain briefly what's happening here. So you know that Jesus was crucified, but he was not crucified alone. There were actually three people, including Jesus, who were crucified. Jesus was in the middle of the three. There were two other criminals that were being crucified on either side of him. So this passage is about the other two guys who were there with Jesus also being crucified. Okay, so now that you have that image. One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God?" he said. "Remember, you are under the same sentence. We are punished justly. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." If you have children or grandchildren, or if you work with children, you know how selfish they can be, right? I read a story about a mom who was making breakfast for her children one morning. She made a plate for each of the children, and two boys come up to the table and immediately start arguing. "I was here first," meaning I get the first one. And the other one says, "Okay, well, you were here first, but I sat down first. Well, I got dressed before you. Well, I made my bed before you." And you know the drill, right? Kids will argue over anything. So the mother says, "Okay, time out. If Jesus were here, what would Jesus say? Let your brother have the first plate, right?" The boys looked at each other and they nodded in agreement. "Okay, so," the one brother says, "Well, you heard Jesus, I'm first." Still selfish. It's a cute story, but that story reminds us that our selfishness doesn't really stop as we get older, right? We constantly battle with selfishness, and we battle with sin in general. That doesn't stop when we're no longer children. And maybe it's not a breakfast plate, but maybe it's with relationships or money or time. Maybe it's with temptation or pride. We know what's right. We know what's right. We want to do what's right. But the Apostle Paul admits that he struggles the same way in Romans chapter 7. Paul says, "I don't understand what I do. I don't do what's right. Instead, I do what I hate." And, you know, I really appreciate Paul's honesty here. I mean, Paul was an apostle of Jesus, meaning, yes, he was a follower, but he also was a firsthand witness. He saw him after Jesus' resurrection. Paul wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. And yet still, he struggled. It's like, whew, I'm normal. I began the lesson here talking about our constant battle with sin. And why did I do that? Because if you can admit that struggle. But also understand God's forgiveness. That means that you can start over. It means that you have a second chance. Because Jesus's crucifixion means that he died for all of your sins. When you ask God for forgiveness, you accept his grace, it means the consequences of all of those sins, the pain, the damage, the hurt that you cause, all of that is forgiven also. And from that moment on, you belong to him. This passage, this scripture that I just read, that's what we saw happening. Just these common lowly criminals. Jesus promised. He promised this guy something. He promised something that he himself could never do. I mean, his time had run out, right? He was at the end of his life. He was facing the death penalty. And the death penalty back then was crucifixion. Nowadays we use the lethal injection, but back then the death penalty was by crucifixion. And he was facing that because he was a thief. But he may have referred to himself as the luckiest man alive. He was arrested, charged, found guilty, and sentenced. And that could have happened anywhere, right? Back in Rome, Rome's power was widespread. But this guy happened to live in Jerusalem. He just so happened to be crucified right next to Jesus. Jesus, the only one who could save him before he died. And he knew that day this thief would still live in paradise, in heaven, with God. Now, again, there were three men being crucified that day. The other guy on the other side of Jesus had that same opportunity, forgiveness, repentance, and paradise. But unfortunately, that never happened for him. Now, the story that happened with those three guys is just the same as our story. Now, of course, we're not facing the death penalty. We're not facing crucifixion. But all of us are facing death. We don't know exactly when or how. We have no idea, of course. It could happen at any time. But those two men had to make a decision. Specifically, they had to make a decision about Jesus. And you know what? It's the same for us. So the question this morning that I want you to think about is, which of those two guys will you be? Luke, who wrote the gospel here, describes this story in four parts. He begins with the angry thief. Now, we assume that it was the person on the left side of Jesus. That's what traditionally has been said. The Bible doesn't say that. But anyway, so then the other guy is on the right side. And it starts with him. He's angry. He's angry. And we could try and look, you know, figure out why he's so angry. Is he angry because he got caught? Because he was convicted? Because he's been sentenced? You know, he's refusing to accept responsibility. You know, Okay, and now he's about to die, so I can understand why he's angry. He knows there's no hope for him. Verse 39 says he is hurling insults at Jesus because Jesus called himself the Christ, the Messiah. But yet here Jesus is not saving himself and he's not saving them. And so his reaction shows who he was. Here he is near death and he's right there next to the Savior of the world, the only one that can save him. And his response is selfish, demanding, bitter. Selfish, demanding, and bitter. And I've met many people through the years, and I'm sure you have as well, that are selfish, demanding, and bitter. I've also met people who think, you know, well, I'll worry about God later, not now. You know, maybe as I'm close to death, I'll reach out to him. They believe that God will give them one last chance. Will he? One last chance? Does he owe us that? And you might think that he does, but he doesn't. Sadly, many people die suddenly with no warning. But here in this passage, God does give a second chance, one final chance. He knew this guy was close to death, right? He's hanging on the cross. And in that type of death, you can't breathe. It's so incredibly painful. You just want to die. And again, the only person who could save his soul is right there, right next to him. And yet all he does is hurl insults at him. Now, he wanted Jesus's help, yeah, but he wanted it in his own way. He wanted help escaping his punishment, getting out of the penalty, avoiding the pain is what he wanted. But he wasn't truly repentant, confessing what he had done wrong with a desire for forgiveness. That wasn't there. And, you know, his response was pretty common, right? We create huge messes, for example, and then we ask God to help us. So does that mean we're asking God to change us? To help us understand how our sin ruins everything? No. What we really mean when we say God help us is, if you're real, God, then I want you to make all of my pain, all of the suffering disappear. And if God shows grace in that way and helps people get through those difficult times, then it's like, thanks, God, and they're back on their own way, living for themselves. So, your relationship with Jesus, what is it that you want? Is it this? Is that what we're looking for? A genie in a bottle? A magic lamp we can rub and the genie appears and solves all of our problems, bows to our every command, and then goes back in? Or do you want a genuine, life-changing, growing, intimate relationship with the living God? Well, that requires faith and trust. That angry thief didn't have it. He asked Jesus for help, but did he really believe that Jesus could help, that he had the power to save him? No. Now, Jesus had the power. He had the authority to, no question. He created the universe. He has the power. He overcome death and rose again. He has the power. He can save you if you are willing to confront and address your sin and trust him. Trust him with your entire life. And with your death. So now the other guy, the second thief. What about him? You know, we don't realize it, but in many ways, both of those guys are pretty similar. They were both guilty of theft. They both deserved their punishment. Crucifixion. In Matthew's gospel, he describes both of them as being angry. Both of them insulting Jesus. Both of them despising Jesus. But then something happens. Something happens with that first guy. His life changes forever. And exactly how and exactly what happened, we don't know. Scripture doesn't expand on that. But clearly, the Holy Spirit convicted him, because what we saw was this angry man who then changed. He stopped ridiculing Jesus. And, you know, I don't know, maybe he started to take a look at him and he noticed that Jesus didn't fire back. That in spite of the injustice, the embarrassment, and the pain, Jesus just took it on. Maybe he heard Jesus praying for his enemies. When he heard Jesus say, God forgive them, they don't know what they're doing. Maybe all of that touched him. Again, we don't know exactly what it was, but obviously something happened there. Verses 40 and 41. But the other criminal rebuked him. He said, don't you fear God since you're under the same sentence? We're punished justly, for we're getting what we deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong. Verse 40, the Greek translation. The first guy says, you don't even fear God? Meaning, you don't even care? Like, what's wrong with you? I mean, you could see instantaneously he had reverence for Jesus. He knew that Jesus hadn't broken any laws. Now, the Roman government, when they crucified someone, they would post your crimes. They would put that there on the cross. What you had done wrong was listed there. And when they looked at Jesus's sign, all it said was, King of the Jews. And yes, that was in one way mocking him, but it showed that he hadn't broken any laws. Somehow, and exactly how we don't know, but somehow that guy understood that Jesus didn't deserve the cross. He recognized that he himself did. He deserved that awful, painful death. But Jesus didn't. Again, in verse 41, he says, he did nothing wrong. It's interesting, today, There's a lot of debate about truth in the media, in social media, in the academic world. There's so much emphasis on being honest with yourself, knowing yourself. Before you can be in a healthy relationship, you must really know yourself. If you want a happy marriage or a happy family, you have to honestly assess yourself. And that's true. But honestly, honesty includes what? It includes a confession of our sins, admitting that we are morally corrupt. And not, you know, that we just, you know, make a mistake every once in a while or we have a few character flaws. No. It means knowing who we are. Understanding our spiritual DNA, that we are born sinful, something that we alone cannot change. We can't control ourselves. That thief got that. He understood that. He looked at Jesus and he saw his innocence. He saw his perfection and holiness. And then he looked at himself and he saw hopelessness. Hopelessness. When you read that passage, or when you watch me sign the passage, what comes to mind? Meaning, what lesson are you learning there? Luke is not trying to teach us that when you're on your deathbed, you can call out to God and he'll answer and forgive you and let you into heaven. That's not what he's trying to teach. And while it is true, that's not the central lesson. The lesson here is this. When we come to God, we must understand that we deserve justice, not mercy. It's just like that thief was saying, we deserve the punishment for our sin. We deserve it. I think so often we deny that. We expect forgiveness, but God demands holiness. And we're not holy on our own. Oh, but, you know, I've been good. Life's been good. I've worked hard. I try to help other people. I take care of my family. I contribute a lot of time for the community, for charity. I obey the laws. Those are all great. But before the Lord, your attempts mean nothing. They mean nothing because he judges your moral life, your heart, your soul, your love for him. Matthew chapter 6, verse 23. You may have everything. I mean, you may have the perfect life. Success, wealth, good friends, a generous heart. You may love the environment. But your soul is still corrupt. We need to understand our souls are corrupt because we were born that way. So again, like the one thief said, we deserve that punishment. But did you notice in verse 42, he asks for mercy. He says, Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, remember me. He pleads. And it's interesting, you may not have noticed, but for someone to call Jesus by his name, you know, hey, Jesus, it actually doesn't happen very often in the Gospels. It's very rare. So it makes me wonder, do you remember what Jesus means? It means God saves. God saves. And that's what he was asking. Jesus, remember me, meaning I trust you. You can save me. I believe it. If you're willing. I want to be saved. And he says, I have nothing to give you in return except my trust. He's offering his life to Jesus. Is your faith like that thief? Are you fully confident that Jesus will remember you and that's all you need for eternity? That's all you need. Jesus remembering you. And that means you'll live with the Father forever. You know, if you ask, Jesus will not forget you. He will remember. In verse 43, Jesus responded saying, don't worry, I will. Don't worry, I'll remember you. You today, you will join me in paradise. And when Jesus promises something, it will happen. You can trust it. It's a guarantee. That moment, that thief's future was secure. He was saved. I mean, his life up until that point was a complete mess. A complete moral failure. And he didn't care about anything or anyone. Never paid attention to right or wrong. He pursued his selfish desires. If he wanted something, he stole it. Why work for it? If he wanted it, he just took it. Regardless of the cost, who he hurt, it didn't matter. But God's Spirit convicted him, woke him up. And he asked, and Jesus answered. He knew for sure, after he died, that his life would continue in heaven. Do you know the same thing for sure? Are you confident? Again, maybe you think, well, that's not really important. You know, that's for those religious people. That's fine. I don't need that. What I'm explaining right now is not about religion. It's not about making us feel good. It's not about having a purpose, feeling important. every person here on earth, every person must decide whether to believe and trust and allow God to change them, or forgiveness, new life, and paradise will never be seen. And I know you may leave this morning just forgetting all this, going on with your Easter day, going out, enjoying the weather, spending time with family. I don't want to think about this religious stuff, think about those, that kind of choices, whether you're going to be in paradise or not. Okay. But one day, you will. You have to. My encouragement right now is, if you decide right now to accept what Jesus is offering, you become the luckiest person alive. And from then on out, your Easters become a true celebration with true meaning. Again, happy Easter. God bless you.
Just lost.